and Hypo-Calvinism is our subject this evening. Calvinism is typically summarized under 5 points. First, total depravity, that all men are completely evil and inclined to all sin, and without any good in them whatsoever, but for the regenerating grace of God. Unconditional election teaches that God, of his mere sovereign will and good pleasure, has chosen and given some men to Jesus Christ for time and eternity as their Saviour and Lord. And limited atonement teaches that it was for them, the elect, that the Lord Jesus laid down his life on the cross. This then, this grace of God, comes to God's people in irresistible grace, so that God regenerates and brings to conscious faith all of his people, excepting those elect who die in infancy, and that they then, being preserved by God, persevere as saints unto the very end. As Scripture itself says, whom he did predestinate, them he also called. And whom he called, them he also justified. And whom he justified, them he also glorified. Romans 8. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ, according as he hath chosen us in him, Christ, before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before him in love. Ephesians 1. For by grace are ye saved, through faith, and that not of yourselves, it is the gift of God, not of works, lest any man should boast. Ephesians 2. Or as we sang from Psalm 115, but our God in the heavens is, what pleased him he hath done. Not unto us, O Lord, not to us, but do thy glory take unto thy name, even for thy truth and for thy mercy's sake. This is, in short, the truth of Calvinism, the doctrines of grace. That salvation is by grace alone, to the glory of God alone. That salvation is all of grace and all of God. From election to the cross, through regeneration and the effectual call, the gift of faith, the imputed righteousness of Christ and justification, through sanctification, the perseverance of the saints, and glorification. The gospel of grace, pure grace, eternal, unchangeable, omnipotent, irresistible grace, sovereign and particular grace. And it is Calvinism, the gospel of grace, that creates, commands, and calls forth joy and thanksgiving, humility and worship. Calvinism. But what is Hyper-Calvinism? And the word hyper means above or over. A hyperactive child is over and above in its activity the norm. A hypercritical person is not just ordinary critical, but over and above critical. The same with hyperinflation, or somebody who's hypersensitive, or if someone hyperventilates, it's over and above the norm. So hyper-Calvinism is over Calvinism, above Calvinism. What then is Hypo-Calvinism. And if hyper means above and over, hypo means under and below. Like a hypodermic injection. It goes hypo or under the skin. Hypothermia is when someone is under the proper body heat. So hypo-Calvinism is under Calvinism, below Calvinism. There's Calvinism, so to speak. Hypo-Calvinism's above, and hypo is below. So how then does one determine if a doctrine, or writing, or sermon, or person, or minister, or church is Calvinistic or hyper-Calvinistic, above Calvinism, or hypo-Calvinistic, under or below it? You say first, Scripture. Scripture, the touchstone for all truth, indeed. Then the question is, but what does Scripture teach? Because you've this minister who says this, the other minister says something else, one church says something, another church or denomination says something different, you've this theologian or that book. So the various ministers, theologians, books, and churches disagree, at least to some extent, or at least some of them do, among themselves. So then we need a proper basis or standard in order to determine what Calvinism is and what hyper-Calvinism is and what hypo-Calvinism is. Otherwise, the judgments will simply be subjective, which everyone with everyone deciding what is right in his own eyes by picking a theologian or a minister or a book that suits him. We need, in short, an objective basis or standard. Others say that John Calvin is the standard to determine Calvinism, and therefore what hyper-Calvinism above it is, and hypo-Calvinism, we know it, yes. And there are two main arguments for saying Calvin is the standard. The first is that Calvin is the most widely respected Reformed theologian. And secondly, someone could argue, we're talking about Calvinism, which is, to some extent at least, named after him. There are some issues, though, that we ought to be aware of in this connection. The first is that Calvin's works, or at least many of them, particularly in the 19th century, were translated by Amiraldian or Hypo-Calvinist translators. And their own particular ideas sometimes intruded into the text. And this isn't just me saying this, this is the scholars who say this. I don't know how big an issue that is or not, but I just mentioned. Secondly, there's the issue of the length of Calvin's work. Calvin's writings consist of 59 volumes in the Corpus Reformatorum, and his commentaries, in the edition that I have, are over 3 foot 6 inches long, or for the younger ones, they're over a meter long. So this raises the question, you know, we're going to have to do a fair bit of reading perhaps to find out what Calvin holds, or want to see the breadth of his teaching. The third point is, this is a bit more controversial, is that the third point of Calvinism, limited atonement or particular redemption, is not always, in Calvin, not always clearly and antithetically correct. There are some statements in Calvin which are obscure, and there are some statements in Calvin which, as they stand, are false. And this weakness in Calvin, and remember he lived before Dordt, has an influence in some of his writings too. It affects some other issues. And then another point regarding taking Calvin as our authority is that Calvin, great theologian as he is only one man. John Calvin himself teaches that there is a sort of hierarchy within his works. Calvin says, regarding his commentaries and sermons, etc., that the best place to go for his theology, where he brings the issues into focus, as it were, is his institutes. The institutes give you a sharper, more concise presentation of Calvin's theology than all his many commentaries and sermons. So the commentaries and sermons are here, then the institutes have a higher rank, so to speak. And then, over and above that, Calvin says, regarding his work, which we call Calvin's Calvinism, he says that his book, here labeled Calvin's Calvinism, goes further and deeper on the controverted subject of God's predestination and related topics than his institutes. So the commentaries and the sermons, the institutes, and then Calvin's Calvinism. And that's why I chose to give the speech on that book in particular. But even better than John Calvin, the basis for determining Calvinism, Hyper-Calvinism, and Hypo-Calvinism is the Canons of Dordt, which were penned in the years 1618 to 19. The Canons of Dordt are the basis because of several reasons. Number one, the Canons of Dordt were written by a body of godly ministers and theologians, not just two or three of them, or even merely one of them, but a body of them. Number two, these Canons of Dordt were written by an international body of godly ministers and theologians from not just one nation or two, but several. There were, of course, the Dutch delegates, also the Germans, the Swiss Reformed, and the British theologians, with men representing especially and specifically England, Scotland, and Wales. The French Reformed were invited, but Louis XIII, the Roman Catholic King of France, barred them from attending, so the French theologians wrote their opinions and sent them to the Synod, and when Synod decided on the Canons of Dordt, the French Church affirmed and approved the canons. And the first quote on your handout states, American Presbyterian B.B. Warfield writes that the Canons of Dordt were, quote, published authoritatively in 1619 as the finding of the Synod of Dordt with the aid of a large body of foreign assessors representing practically the whole Reformed world. The canons, therefore, possess the moral authority of the decrees of practically an ecumenical council throughout the whole body of Reformed churches. And so the Canons of Dordt are a church creed. A church creed. Not merely the writings of a minister or a theologian, but a church creed forged in the heat of the battle with the Arminian heresies and officially formulated and adopted by the church as binding doctrine. This is what the canons themselves say. This is quote 2 in the handout from the conclusion after the 5 points. It states that this synod, in the name of the Lord, conjures as many as piously call upon the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, to judge of the faith of the Reformed churches, not from the calumnies, which on every side are heaped upon it, nor from the private expressions of a few among ancient and modern teachers, often dishonestly quoted or corrupted and wrested to a meaning quite foreign to their intention, but, especially this, from the public confessions of the churches themselves, from the declaration of the Orthodox doctrine confirmed by the unanimous consent of all and each of the members of the whole synod. And so it is that the canons of Dordt are actually the basis of the 5 points of Calvinism. Calvin's name is given to the 5 points of Calvinism, but it's not Calvin as such who is the basis of the 5 points of Calvinism. There are precisely 5 points of Calvinism, and not 4 or 12 or 8, because there were 5 heads in the canons of Dordt. And the 5 points of Calvinism are what they are and cover what they cover because the 5 heads of the canons of Dordt are what they are and cover what they cover. This point is worth making too. The canons of Dordt are also ideally suited to be the standard for Calvinism, and therefore determine what's hyper-Calvinism above it and what's hypo-Calvinism beneath or under it, because of their length. They're not too short. If they were too short, they would lack sufficient detail to make the controverted issues clear. They're not too short. And they're not too long. It was making too long, like 59 volumes, and then it's going to be inaccessible or too detailed for God's people. Instead, the canons of Dordt are some 26 pages in our Green Creeds book, found in the back of the pews in front of you, pages 155 through 180. And so the canons of Dordt are the best, the number one, the standard for Calvinism, and therefore for hyper-Calvinism and for hypo-Calvinism. Because the canons are the basis for the famous 5 points of Calvinism. They're international, they're official, and they're creedal, and they're the right sort of length to use as a test and standard. So now, what is hyper-Calvinism over and above Calvinism? The classic historic definition of hyper-Calvinism is that it involves 2 errors especially, or even a twofold error. Namely, that the minister, on the one hand, according to Hyper-Calvinism, is not to call all his hearers to repent and believe the gospel. And on the other hand, Hyper-Calvinism says that the unregenerate, those who are not yet converted, are not obliged to repent and believe savingly. Let me explain this further. The first of those two false doctrines involves the minister's preaching to the unregenerate, or even the personal witness of a believer to an unsaved person. The minister must not command unbelievers to repent or turn from their sins. He must not convert them. He must not command them to be converted, to trust in Jesus Christ, or to believe to the saving of their souls. Only, according to Hyper-Calvinism, only the regenerate, those who are sensible or aware of their sins, may be so called, says Hyper-Calvinism. The minister, if he addresses someone who's unconverted, can only exhort him to a legal repentance and faith, not a gospel repentance and faith. I can see from the looks that I'm getting that this sounds strange to you. I can sympathize. The other side of this error involves the obligation of the unregenerate under the preaching. The unregenerate has no duty to repent or believe in Jesus. And so the Hyper-Calvinist denies duty repentance and duty faith. Those are the technical terms. He denies duty repentance and duty faith. Therefore, according to Hyper-Calvinism, it is not a sin for the unbeliever to refuse to turn from his evil ways and trust in Christ for forgiveness and everlasting life. And it's not a sin because it wasn't a duty that God charged him with. These strange views are those especially of some 18th century English Baptists. Some of you may have heard of Joseph Hussey, John Bryan, and John Gill, the latter being more famous. Some 18th century English Baptists and their successors, especially in England and America. And these views are enshrined in the Gospel Standard Articles of Faith, particularly Articles 24, 26, 29, and 33. Now, I haven't time now, and I imagine you'll be quite relieved at this, to go into the ins and outs of their false positions, the erroneous reasons they give for holding to their particular notions, and then our counter-arguments and back and forth. We're not going to get into that. But what we do need to see in this lecture is that this is Hyper-Calvinism. It's been historically called Hyper-Calvinism. It's been judged as over and above Calvinism, and their judgment is correct. Because the Canons of Dordt declare, this is Canons 2.5, quote 3 on the handout, "Moreover, the promise of the gospel is that whosoever believeth in Christ crucified shall not perish, but have everlasting life. This promise, together with the command to repent and believe, ought to be declared and published to all nations and to all persons promiscuously and without distinction, to whom God, out of his good pleasure, sends the gospel." Canons 2.5 says, "This must be preached, the gospel, all the truth of the scriptures as it centers upon Jesus Christ and his work of salvation." And as well as the gospel, and part of it is the promise of the gospel. The promise of the gospel is that all who believe in Jesus receive full remission of all sins and all the blessings of the kingdom of heaven. So there's the gospel, that's to be preached, the promise of the gospel, and the command of the gospel. The command of the gospel is that all must repent and believe in Jesus, turning from all iniquity and trusting in Christ alone for all their salvation. And this, the gospel, the promise of the gospel, and the command of the gospel, to repent and believe, must be declared and preached to all nations and to all persons promiscuously and without distinction. So it's not, oh, you're sensible of your sins, I'll command you to repent. You're not sensible, I won't command you. Promiscuously and without distinction, to whom God in his good pleasure sends the gospel. And so the canons also, over against Hyper-Calvinism, affirm that unbelief and impenitence are sin. Canons 1:5, Canons 2:6, Canons 3:4:19, and therefore we know that all obviously have a duty before God to repent and believe. Believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved, and thy house. Acts 16, verse 31. By the way, it's interesting that most Hyper-Calvinists were, in the 18th century, and are Baptists, not Reformed or Presbyterian. And so these Hyper-Calvinists reject duty repentance, reject duty faith, forbid the minister to call everyone to repent and believe, that's over and above Calvinism. And also, as Baptists, their position is also Hypo-Calvinism, under and below Calvinism, because they explicitly reject, and it's in their articles too, standard gospel articles, they explicitly reject God's covenant with believers and their seed, requiring covenant or family or household or infant baptism, which was the position of all the delegates at the Synod and of all the Reformed and Presbyterian creeds. As quote 4 puts it, Canons 1:17, this is part of the 5 points of Calvinism. It says that the Word of God testifies that the children of believers are holy in virtue of the covenant of grace in which they, together with their parents, are comprehended. Now, in addition to the twofold Hyper-Calvinist heresy, the denying of duty repentance and duty faith, and denying the external promiscuous call commanding all within earshot to turn from their sins and trust in the only Savior. As well as that, there are other errors that can be rightly called Hyper-Calvinist on the basis of the Canons of Dordt. Someone who makes God the author of sin, who actually makes God the author of sin, is a Hyper-Calvinist. And Canons 1, Article 15, call that blasphemy. Incidentally, this charge of making God the author of sin was the wicked slander that the Arminians made at Dordt and still make today, that we do make God the author of sin, which we strenuously deny as Reformed Christians. And the conclusion of the Canons of Dordt Amongst the many calumnies heaped against the Reformed by the Arminians mentions this, they charge us spuriously and wickedly of making God the author of sin. But those who do, and there are some, who actually say, we make God the author of sin, that's hyper-Calvinism. Because it's above the Canons of Dordt, which is the standard. Those who attribute, even in part, the guilt or fault of man's not repenting and believing to God. That's hyper-Calvinism too, over and above the teaching of the authoritative canons. If someone says that even part of the guilt or fault for man's sin or failure to repent and believe is to be attributed to God or to Christ or to some defect or insufficiency in the cross or to the gospel, that's hyper-Calvinism, because the Canons of Dordt very clearly say that all the sin and the blame and the guilt and the fault for rejecting the gospel lies completely, wholly, and entirely upon the person who rejects the truth of God's word in Jesus. Canons 1:5, Canons 2:6, Canons 3:4-9. In general, too, it is hyper-Calvinism to abuse the truth of the absolute sovereignty of God as an excuse for laziness or spiritual carelessness. If someone teaches that man is a mere stock or block, but not a rational moral creature, just a stock or a block, or in 21st century language, a robot. If somebody teaches that, that's hyper-Calvinism, because the canons oppose that in Canons 3:4, Article 16. If someone teaches that election or the certainty of perseverance encourages pride or carnal living or antinomianism, setting aside the law of God as the rule of life for the thankful, justified believer, that's hyper-Calvinism. Because the truth that the canons hold forth is that election and the certainty of perseverance work in us humility, piety, filial reverence, and love for the Lord. Canons 1:13, 5, 12 and 13, and Canons 5, rejection of errors, 6. It is also hyper-Calvinism to deny or weaken the call to godly living. Is it a bit stuffy? Should we open the back door and let a bit of fresh air in? What do you think? You decide. Instead, the canons teach the diligent use of the means that God has appointed and which he uses for our spiritual growth and safety. The canons teach, diligently listen to the preaching of the word, diligently avail of the sacraments, submit to church discipline, read and meditate upon the word on your own and in your families, yield to the exhortations and threatenings of Scripture, and embrace the promises, and stir yourself up, and be zealous. And it's not Calvinism, but hyper-Calvinism that says, you'll be all right. Just you take it easy. You don't have to obey these commands of God. That's hyper-Calvinism. The canons teach what I've been saying in Canons 1:16, 3:4-17, and 5:14. The canons teach it is the duty of Christians to pray for the unconverted that God might give them salvation in Jesus Christ according to his will. Canons 3:4, Article 15. And if you think of the fifth point of Calvinism, or the fifth head of Calvinism, It's deliberately called the perseverance of the saints. Not even the preservation of the saints. It's called the perseverance of the saints. And that fifth article calls upon all Christians to mortify the flesh, pray, press forward to the goal of perfection, watch and pray, repent, yield godly sorrow over your sins, preserve a good conscience, and perform good works, amongst other callings. Hyper-Calvinism denies or weakens that. Calvinism affirms our calling. So having said what hyper-Calvinism is, and defining it now, according to the canons, which are the standard, not what you or I or some individual minister or Christian or theologian might think, we need to ask ourselves, what is not hyper-Calvinism? What is not over and above Calvinism? It is not hyper-Calvinism to teach that Jesus Christ died for the elect alone. John Wesley said that was hyper-Calvinism. John Wesley forbade anybody to go to a church which taught that Christ died only for the elect. He said, the teaching that Christ died only for the elect is hyper-Calvinism. Wesley was a liar. The teaching that Jesus Christ died only for the elect is Calvinism. That's what Head 2 of the Canons of Dordt is all about, over against the Arminian teaching that Christ died for everybody. The notion that Christ died for all men, the Reformed faith, the canons teach, is heresy. The Arminian heresy, dragged out of hell, to echo the rejection of errors in Head 2. It is not hyper-Calvinism to deny the notion that Jesus died for all men in some sense. Jesus did not die for all men head for head in some sense. The Canons of Dordt teach, Canons 2, Article 2, substitution. That is, Jesus took the place on the cross of all those whom the Father gave him, so that he bare the wrath which was due to us for our sins, because our sins were imputed to him. He became guilty in our stead and bore the punishment we deserved. And so the notion that Jesus died for all men in some sense is contrary to substitutionary atonement, as taught in Canons 2:2. In Canons 2:8, it's quote 5 on the sheet, teaches that the death of Christ was for, I'm just picking out now the bits that are underlined because it's a lengthy article, was for all the elect, line 2. God bestowed upon them alone all the blessings of salvation Christ purchased by the cross, line 3. And then line 5 is even more emphatic, that this redemption is for all those and those only who were from eternity chosen unto salvation. Some say that hyper-Calvinism is teaching that absolutely everything is eternally and unchangeably decreed by God. That's not hyper-Calvinism. That's Calvinism. That's Calvinism. Canons 1:6. Calvinism teaches that absolutely everything is eternally and unchangeably decreed by God, and to call that hyper-Calvinism is slander. Some say that it is hyper-Calvinism to teach that God eternally and unchangeably decrees to reprobate some people. Reprobation, they say, is hyper-Calvinism. No! No! Reprobation is Calvinism. And it's a downright lie to say that reprobation is hyper-Calvinism. Reprobation is Calvinism. And the canons mention it, for example, in Heads 1, Article 6, 15, 16, and 18. In fact, Canons 1.6 teaches that election and reprobation are parts of one decree. One decree. So that reprobation is just as eternal and just as unchangeable and just as unconditional as election. Some say that if you teach that a certain unchangeable number alone will be saved, that's Hyper-Calvinism. But it is not Hyper-Calvinism to teach that a certain number will be saved, and that God knows that number and has determined the people who are embraced in that number, and that the rest won't be saved. This isn't Hyper-Calvinism. This is Calvinism. Canons 1.7, Canons 1.10, Canons 1.11. There's a lot of lies going on here in the calling of people Hyper-Calvinists. Some people say that if you read or quote Romans 9 a lot, that makes you a Hyper-Calvinist. That's a sure sign you're a Hyper-Calvinist. But you know, Romans 9, that chapter, is expressly quoted 5 times within the canons. I didn't have time in preparing this speech. Maybe some of you will. If you do, drop me an email or phone. It's possible that that's the chapter most quoted in the actual canons themselves. It's possible. And if it isn't, it must be very near the top of the list. And it is especially Romans 9, verses 11 through 20, the heart of the chapter, that is quoted. With your Bible open, verse 11 is quoted twice. For the children being not yet born, Rebecca's children, neither having done any good or evil, that the purpose of God according to election might stand, not of works, but of him that calleth, verse 12 is also quoted, it was said unto her, the elder shall serve the younger. Verse 13 is quoted, as it is written, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Verse 16 is quoted. So then, it is not of him that willeth, nor of him that runneth, but of God that showeth mercy. Verse 18 is quoted. Therefore hath he mercy on whom he will have mercy, and whom he will, he hardeneth. And verse 20 is quoted. Against all Arminian objections, nay, but, O man, who art thou to reply against God? Shall the thing formed say to him that formed it, why hast thou made me thus? Some people say that it is Hyper-Calvinism to teach that God's eternal and unconditional reprobation issues in his sovereign hardening of them. But that's not Hyper-Calvinism. That's Calvinism. Canons 1, Rejection of Errors 8, it's quote 6 on the sheet, says, for this is firmly decreed by God, according to his one decree of election and reprobation. This is firmly decreed. And then 3 texts are quoted. First, he hath mercy on whom he will, and whom he will he hardeneth. Romans 9, verse 18. And that word will, in our English, it's also the same in the Authorized Version, will means wish, desire, want. God has mercy on whom he wants to have mercy, desires to have mercy, and whom he wills or wishes or wants, he hardens them. He sovereignly hardens as part of his eternal purpose of reprobation. And then the second verse quoted, unto you, believers, first in the first instance, the apostles, unto you it is given, said Jesus, to know the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, but to them it is not given. God, according to his will of reprobation, chooses not to give to some people the understanding of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And then thirdly, likewise, Jesus says, his prayer in Matthew 11, I thank thee, O Father, Lord of heaven and earth, that thou didst hide these things from the wise and understanding or prudent, and didst reveal them unto babes. Yea, Father, for so it was well pleasing in thy sight. Here Jesus says that God's hiding the truth from some people is well pleasing in his sight. And Jesus made it a grounds for thanksgiving, and he prayed to God and says, Father, I thank thee that thou hast hidden these things from some people, the ones reprobated and not chosen. Sovereign hardening, sovereign not giving, sovereign hiding of the truth of salvation from the reprobate. Those are fearful things. But it's what Jesus and Paul says here. It's what the canons say. This is Calvinism. Not hyper-Calvinism. Calvinism. And then Canons 5, Rejection of Errors 1, number 7 on the sheet, just quoting the last part, the bit that's underlined, says, the elect obtained it. This is quoting Romans 11, verse 7. The context in Romans 11 and in Canons 5 here is salvation. The elect obtained it, salvation, and the rest were hardened. Calvinism. Sometimes people will say too that it is hyper-Calvinism to teach that God's eternal and unconditional reprobation goes hand in hand with his hatred of them. You couldn't say that. You couldn't say that God hates people. Admittedly, that's a fearful thing. But we want to go as far as Scripture goes, and no further, and as far as the Reformed faiths and the Calvinism goes. Well, what does Canons 1.10 say? Canons 1.10 at the very bottom of the front side of the sheet, going over the page, teaches, Jacob have I loved, but Esau have I hated. Romans 9, verse 13. Others claim that it is hyper-Calvinism to maintain that God does not desire or wish or want or will to save the reprobate. You see, God doesn't desire or wish or will to save the reprobate. Hyper-Calvinism. That's the charge. And this brings up the important issue of the external call of the gospel, and particularly the external call of the gospel with regard to its sincerity, its seriousness, its earnestness. And in section 9 of the sheet, the Arminians say the external call of the gospel is sincere and earnest in one sense, and for one reason, and the Reformed say it's sincere and serious for another reason. Read with me now 9a on the handout. This is what Arminianism teaches, and this is the opinion of the Arminians, which the Arminians presented to the Synod of Dordt. This was there on paper at the Synod. This is the Arminian view. Whomever God calls to salvation, he calls seriously. That is, with a sincere and completely unhypocritical intention and will to save. And that word will means wish, want, desire. The Arminians taught that God wishes and wants and desires to save. And that's how it is. Everybody hears the gospel. That's how it is that the preaching is sincere and unhypocritical. Then it goes on to say, we the Arminians, do not assent to the opinion of those who hold that God calls certain ones only externally, whom he does not will or wish or want to call internally and save, that is, as truly converted, even before the grace of calling has been rejected. So the Arminians said that the gospel preaching is sincere and earnest and unhypocritical, precisely because when the minister preaches the gospel, God earnestly wishes and wants and desires to save everybody, whether they're saved or not. That's the Arminian position, which was brought by the Arminians officially on paper to the Synod of Dordt. And lo and behold, the position of the Arminians is precisely the position today called the free offer. It was the position of the Arminians as brought to the Canons of Dordt. But the Reformed teaching, now we come to 9b, in direct response to this, the Reformed position is, Canons 3, 4, 8, as many as are called by the gospel are unfeignedly called. There's a sincere call, all right. And here's how it's sincere. God hath most earnestly and truly shown in his word what is pleasing to him. Namely, that those who are called should come to him. He, moreover, seriously promises eternal life and rest to as many as shall come to him and believe on him. So what makes the preaching of the gospel, the external call, sincere or serious according to Calvinism of the Synod of Dordt and the Canons? It is not said that the preaching of the gospel is sincere because God desires or wills or wishes or wants to save everybody who hears it. As the Arminians said, and as was said in the bit of paper before them when they were drafting their own position. Instead, the Reformed said, the preaching of the gospel is sincere or serious because of two things. Number one, because the preaching of the gospel declares that repentance and faith are pleasing to God. They're acceptable to him. They're in full command, in full accord with his will of command. And on the other hand, unbelief, impenitence are wicked, unpleasing, and kindle his holy anger against those who wickedly refuse to repent and believe. That's why the command is sincere. God says sincerely, and it can be preached to absolutely anybody, this is what pleases me. This is what you ought to do. And not doing it makes me terribly angry. Repentance is pleasing. Confessing your sins, turning to Jesus Christ, that's appropriate. That's attractive. That's right and just and good. Which is a different thing from saying that God earnestly desires and wishes and wants it. God says, this is right and good. I approve. I accept this. This pleases me. That's the first thing. And secondly, the canons teach, this is in the second sentence of Canons 3:48, the call of the gospel is sincere because God seriously promises eternal life and rest to as many as shall come to him and believe in him. God says seriously, all you who repent, you will receive eternal life and they may have. God is serious and sincere in preaching the gospel in that he threatens that those who do not repent, who will not believe in Jesus, that he will punish them with everlasting fire in hell. That's pretty serious, and God keeps his word and means exactly what he says. And this teaching, Canons 3, 4, 8, is exactly what we teach and preach in this church. And what we have from the beginning and to the present day always taught and teach, but not the Arminian view, which the Canons of Dordt rejected, and which is presented in 9a, that God wills and wishes and desires and wants to save everybody to hear the gospel. Not that. Not that. Furthermore, it is not hyper-Calvinism if a church does not have a Sunday evening gospel service. I've heard that one too. Your church doesn't have a Sunday evening gospel service. That is a service in which all things are geared and addressed, especially for unbelievers. Now tonight I'm not discussing the pros and cons of a Sunday evening gospel service, saying whether it's wise or unwise, or there are advantages or disadvantages. That's not the issue tonight. But what I am saying is, because this is the issue of this speech, and because this false charge has been made, it is erroneous, to say the least, to say that a church is hyper-Calvinist because it does not devote the Sunday evening gospel service, week in, week out, 52 times a year, to address unconverted people. And I'll tell you why. This Sunday evening gospel service was not the practice of John Calvin, or the Reformers, or any of the fathers at the Synod of Dordt, so far as we are aware. This was not the practice of the Reformed churches in Britain, or France, or the Netherlands, or Germany, or Switzerland, and their delegates. And it is, church historically speaking, the idea of a Sunday evening gospel service is a relatively new thing. It's been present pretty much for the last 100 or perhaps 200 years. It's been present amongst some evangelicals and many fundamentalists. Now they choose to do that, that's up to them. But you cannot say that those who do not do that, including the people who pen the Canons of Dordt, that they are hyper-Calvinists because they don't have a practice which they adopted a couple or two or three hundred years later. Not hyper-Calvinists. And interestingly too, if you looked at this practice of a Sunday evening gospel service, historically, and in the majority of churches, I think it would be fair to say that the ones who do it are mainly Arminian or hypo-Calvinist, and that those Calvinists who do it, genuine Calvinists according to the Synod of Dordt, would be in a minority of those who do it. I think those things couldn't even be gainsaid either. And you understand that it's not our point so much to attack, but to explain that this is an unfair charge, that that's not hyper-Calvinism. Moving from hyper-Calvinism, above and beyond Calvinism, what about hypo-Calvinism, under and below Calvinism? Well, think first of all of the 5 points or heads. A one-point Calvinist, who let's say claims to believe in the perseverance of the saints, is a hypo-Calvinist. If there are 5 points to Calvinism and you only hold one of them, well, that, by anybody's definition, is being under Calvinism. Calvinism is 5 points. Not 2 points, hypo-Calvinism. 3 points, hypo-Calvinism. 4 points, hypo-Calvinism. You understand that I'm not engaging in some sort of name-calling here. I'm simply explaining from the nature of the case that a 1, 2, 3, or 4 point Calvinist is, by anybody's definition, a hypo-Calvinist. And, to throw into the mix, the points of Calvinism, which a 1, 2, 3, or 4 point Calvinist doesn't hold, he holds Arminian, the Arminian opposition to it, which Arminian views every Calvinist is bound to reject as false and heretical. An attack on election or reprobation, false and heretical. The denial of total depravity, false and heretical. Christ dying for everybody, false and heretical. Resistible grace, false and heretical. The falling away of saints, false, heretical, Arminian. And so Amoraldianism, I'm not going to explain it if you're not familiar with it, Amoraldianism, which says we're four-point Calvinists, they deny that Christ died only for the elect, that is hypo-Calvinism, by definition. The Amoraldians have an election in which, according to us, the first decree of election, God chooses and wants to save everybody. That's hypo-Calvinism too, because the Canons of Dordt only know of one unconditional eternal election. That's hypo-Calvinism, and that's why our Amoraldianism is a halfway house between Arminianism and Calvinism. It's inconsistent, it's a compromise position, because all 5 points, logically, biblically, creedally, hang together and stand or fall together. It is also hypo-Calvinistic for a church to drop the rejection of errors. The Canons of Dordt just don't only say, this is the truth of all 5 points. Then they have a section at the end of each of the points, or heads, therefore we reject these errors that were taught by the Arminians. And it is hypo-Calvinistic to reject the rejection of errors or leave them out, because it's Calvinism, as defined by the Synod of Dordt, to put them in and keep them in, because they're important. This is hypo-Calvinism too, to refer to election or elect as the frozen chosen. Now I take that as blasphemous. Jesus Christ and the scripture writings speak repeatedly of election. And how dare some person refer to the frozen chosen? The Canons of Dordt, to take one article, picked several, explain that election is the source of praise and joy and fruit. Canons 1, rejection 7. It is hypo-Calvinism to murmur, to grumble, to complain, to snipe at election and reprobation. And there's a whole article given to this. Canons 1, 18. And they quote Romans 9. Nay, but O man, who art thou that answerest against God? That's hypo-Calvinism. It is hypo-Calvinism, not just my opinion, but this is Orthodox, creedal, Reformed Calvinism. It is hypo-Calvinism to dislike or refuse or balk at preaching of election and reprobation as the one eternal decree of God with respect to men and angels. Because Canons 1:14 says that election and reprobation must be preached as part of the whole counsel of God. Preach wisely, preach for the edification of the saints, preach for the glory of God, but emphatically, preach. And it is to be wiser than God to claim, I wouldn't like to preach that. And it is to be a coward to say, the congregation wouldn't like that. That's hypo-Calvinism. It is also, and this isn't just my opinion, this is Orthodox Calvinism, it is also hypo-Calvinism to tolerate, approve of, condone, endorse, or praise those who deny and attack election and reprobation. Canons 1:6, this is the 10th note on the handout. Canons 1:6 describes, I'm reading it in an underlined bit, certain people who attack election and reprobation, this one decree of God, as, quote, men of perverse, impure, and unstable minds. And it says about these men of perverse, impure, and unstable minds that they rest, the truth of election and reprobation, quote, to their own destruction. That's Calvinism. That's Calvinism. And the conclusion of the Synod of Dordt, number 11, the bit that's indented, contains quotes that the Arminians said against Calvinism at that day. I want you to note that all of these things, or at least most of them, were, for instance, held by John Wesley. You could go through the writings of John Wesley and you could pluck out things that teach all the things here that the Arminians were scandalously charging against the Reformed churches. That the Reformed doctrine of predestination by its own genius and necessary tendency leads off the minds of men from piety and religion. Wesley said that. That it's an opiate administered to the flesh and the devil. It's a stronghold of Satan. Yep. Satan lies in wait for all, but the Reformed faith, yep, that's what he taught. It wounds multitudes. It mortally strikes through many with despair on security. Yep. It makes God the author of sin. Yep, he said that. Unjust, tyrannical. Yep. Wesley even said, the God of Calvinism is my devil. Your God is my devil. And then it's interpolated Stoicism, Manichaeism, and so on. It renders men carnally secure. Yeah, these are the classical Arminian attacks and slanders of the Reformed faith in the 17th century and in the 21st century. And on this score, Wesley and all consistent Arminians attacked all 5 points of Calvinism. I hate your election, I hate your reprobation. Charles Wesley even wrote hymns against reprobation called it blasphemy. I hate this doctrine of total depravity because I'm a preacher of free will. The idea that Christ died for the elect alone is blasphemous. Said Wesley, grace is irresistible, it depends always on the free will of man, and that God can save people and then they can be lost. That was his teaching. And all those things are heresy. Heresy. As well as that, Wesley taught charismatic ideas, entire sanctification, he had women preaching, and he gutted his own creed, the 39 articles, and he didn't believe many of its own articles, and therefore when he had a chance, he left them out in his Methodist creed. That's hypo-Calvinism, serious hypo-Calvinism. The tragedy of our day is that those who hold to Calvinism, full-blooded Calvinism, as summed up in the creed, are called hyper-Calvinists. And those who praise the enemies of Calvinism, and who use the very language that our creed reprobates and says is blasphemy and scurrilous, they are the ones praised by the majority, I dare say, in our apostate, wicked age, as great men, great men. And it's an absolute disgrace. I also think that it should be said that it is emphatically hypo-Calvinism, under Calvinism, to sing hymns in God's worship as if he could be praised by such stuff, that teach Arminianism. And this goes on. Hymns that teach, in their ordinary and deliberate sense, free will. That everybody has the power to believe in Jesus with a little bit of assistance. Free will. Which the Canons of Dordt say, quote, is the proud heresy of Pelagius. Sing that to God as worship in the Church of Jesus Christ. That's hypo-Calvinism, free will. Romans 9 verse 16, as quoted in Canons 3:4-19, declares that salvation is not of him that willeth, nor of him that loveth, but it is emphatically and totally and from beginning to end of God that showeth mercy. Hymns too, which sing of resistible grace, what an offering to bring before God. Hymns which speak of a universal atonement, an ineffectual atonement, which cannot save a single person, unless, this is the deciding factor, man's free will. Saying that to God, an absolute disgrace, a waste of paper, but then to bring that as an offering to the Most High. Hymns too that sing against, in short, God's decree, Christ's cross, and the Spirit's grace, as taught in the Scriptures, as summed and defined as binding doctrine for anybody who claims to be a Calvinist and Reformed in the Canons of Dordt. And then what about total depravity? What about total depravity? In our day, there are subtle spirits about who say, to try and get around this, that all men are depraved in all their parts. There's evil in man's will, in man's inclination of mind and affections, but he's not totally evil in all the parts or segments or aspects of man. That's a subtle heresy. And then they say that we who hold total depravity, like the Canons teach, that's that man is depraved in all faculties and aspects, and totally depraved in all faculties and aspects, then we are standard as teaching absolute depravity. And those who teach partial depravity, that man has some good in him, he's not all evil, then say that they teach total depravity. Paul Daniels, slip of the wrist, cunningly devised heresies. Whereas the Canons of Dordt, in Head 3 and 4, Articles 1 to 3, 15, Rejection of Errors 4, and all the rest, teach very clearly that there's no good in man. He's depraved in all areas, and completely in all areas. That's hypo-Calvinism. That's hypo-Calvinism, that notion that man is not totally depraved in all areas. There are also those too who claim that man can believe before he's regenerated and claim to be Calvinist. But the Canons of Dordt, 3-4, articles 11 through 14, most emphatically deny that heresy and say regeneration and then faith. And now I should have had this on the sheet, but I didn't. Head 3-4, rejection of errors 4, is worth reading. It's on page 171 of the Green Creeds book. It says that having taught the truth, we reject the error of those who teach, this is Canons 3-4, rejection of error 4 on page 171, we reject the errors of those who teach that the unregenerate man is not really nor utterly dead in sin, nor destitute of all powers of the spiritual good, but they teach, this is the error that we reject, that man can yet hunger and thirst after righteousness and life, and man can yet offer the sacrifice of a contrite and a broken spirit which is pleasing to God. Rejecting. These are contrary to the express testimony of Scripture. Quote, ye were dead through trespass and sins. Ephesians 2. And every imagination of the thoughts of man's heart was only evil continually. Genesis 5 and Genesis 8. Moreover, to hunger and thirst after deliverance from misery and after life, and to offer unto God the sacrifice of a broken spirit is peculiar to the regenerate and those who are called blessed. That's what Calvinism teaches. Real Calvinism, not the phony stuff that's presented in our day. And I'll quote another article, final one, regarding faith. It's the very bottom of the second page, Canons 3-4-14. It is Arminian to say that faith is the gift of God means that it is offered by God to man to be accepted or rejected at his pleasure. That faith is a gift, they say, it is sort of held out for you, and whether you accept it or not, like a present of your man may give you, depends on you, whether you accept it or whether you reject it. Instead, the canons teach that faith is the gift of God because it is in reality conferred, breathed, and infused into man, and that God produces in us by his irresistible sweet grace the power and the willing so that we do actually believe and trust in Jesus. And if faith is a gift, is not this, it's held out whether you can accept it or reject it. Since faith is the necessary means that God has appointed for someone to appropriate and enjoy salvation, you can just as easily say that salvation, when the Bible speaks about it as a gift, is not that it's out there for you to accept or reject according to your will. When faith is described in the Bible and the Reformed faith is a gift, it means that God works it in you. That God actually saves and converts and delivers you. And finally, to bring this to a conclusion, it is hypo-Calvinism to teach or to insinuate that Calvinism is too difficult and too deep. The conclusions of the Canons of Dordt. The very first sentence says, and this, all that's been taught, and this is the perspicuous means clear, simple, and ingenuous, and ingenuous means clear or frank. This is the clear, simple, frank declaration of the Orthodox doctrine respecting the five articles. It is Orthodox Calvinism to teach that the 5 points, as taught here in the Canons of Dordt, aren't cripplingly hard, aren't way over people's head, but are clear, simple, and frank. And as I teach these canons to church members, I say to them, you know, it is difficult though. The many windy turnings of the Arminians. That's difficult. I struggle to understand what in all the world they're up to at times. But Calvinism is as clear as day. And if we see it as difficult at times, it's because we've got some Arminian leaven in us. It's hard not to have a sense, being born totally depraved, and so many false doctrines circulating. And now lastly, we need to note that being a creed, the canons of Dordt, simple, clear, orthodox, definitive Calvinism, was used as a standard right from its inception in the churches, so that Arminian ministers, those who were teaching contrary to these articles upon its acceptation, were deposed. And we say to those who would slander us as hyper-Calvinists, if you were a real Calvinist, when was the last time you deposed ministers for teaching hyper-Calvinism, for teaching, telling everybody that God loved them, that Christ died for them, for insisting on free will, telling people that whether they're saved or not depends ultimately on them? The Canons of Dordt, the creed, were used, rightly too, to depose ministers. Elders and deacons in Reformed churches must uphold this. And any office bearer in this church, or any church which is creedally Calvinistic and Reformed, any office bearer who teaches contrary to this is to be immediately suspended. That's Calvinism. That's real Calvinism. Not just talking about the Reformed faith, or I'm a Calvinist, and isn't it great that some new toy or trick that you have? Real Calvinism, where it's insisted upon as the truth of God, without games and fooling around. Then it is hypo-Calvinistic too to have in a church all sorts of members who are Arminian. To allow Arminians to teach the children of the church in Sunday school their foolish notions. And nobody apparently really bothers about this. This can be okay, but the real threat is some hyper-Calvinism out there, when it's wrongly labeled upon people who are actually genuine creedal Calvinists, but within is a whole mess and nest of Arminianism, ruining the church, harming people's spiritual lives, leading the children astray and open to further errors. Instead, it ought to be said that Calvinism is to be preached officially, thoroughly preached. Preached as the truth of God from the scriptures in accordance with the creed, and hyper-Calvinism opposed and rejected and exposed for the error that it is, and hypo-Calvinism rejected and exposed likewise, so that you stand for it and you suffer for it and you encourage people. Here, you want to know what Calvinism is? This is the genuine article. If you want hardback, here. And if you want a good commentary on it, here. Because there are many winds of doctrine that would lead you astray. And here the church finds peace and comfort in a day of departure and torpor. Amen. Let us pray. Our Father in heaven, we ask that thou grant us joy and peace through believing, that thou would enlighten our minds, renew our wills, and give us courage and steadfastness for the truth. Forgive, Father, our sins. Humble us and work worship through thy truth. For we ask in Jesus' name. Amen.